Right now, we are really thrilled to be hosting this conversation about modern gay rights and World War I. It really is a part and parcel to our mission, which is to remember, interpret, and understand the Great War and its enduring impact on the global history. And well, queer history itself has a history. And Dr. Carolyn Radesky wrote the Organization of American History award-winning dissertation examining how it was constructed with a particular focus in 1880 to 1920. Now, this research that she did was supported by the Mellon Foundation, the Council on Library and Information Resources, the American Association of University Women, and the University of Iowa, both her alma mater and where she is currently a visiting assistant professor teaching gender, race, and sexuality in the history department. In addition, Dr. Radesky serves as the review editor for the American Historical Association's Committee on Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, and Transgender History and provides workshops around Iowa on teaching queer history with secondary teachers, which means that at the end of our 45 to 50 minute talk, when we're in the midst of Q&A and talking about ways that you might engage this in the classroom, particularly if you are from one of four states that require this history to be part and parcel of your classroom teaching. She is really well equipped. So again, I just invite you to ask questions throughout. If by chance that question is answered during the talk, we'll certainly let you know. But again, it is showing up live and being able to be a part of the conversation that is always such a delight in these conversations with you. So again, thank you for joining us. And Dr. Radesky, thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. And I want to thank the World War I Museum, the National World War I Museum, and Laura for everything that you did to set this up. I greatly appreciate it. So much so. I will get started. And thank you to everyone who's come tonight. I think we're all glad to get away from television screens tonight. So I really appreciate you being here. So I'm going to share my screen and we're going to go over, I'm just going to go over my talk. And then if you have any questions at all, please don't hesitate to contact me or to ask them. Okay.
We got it. Thank you.
Talk begins in 1917 as 25-year-old Henry Gerber, the man pictured here, attempted to commit suicide. Ashamed of his love for men and thinking he could never pursue his feelings, he took poison in the hopes of ending it all. However, his attempt failed and he woke up in a Chicago asylum after police read his suicide note, where he admitted his desire. He endured electroshock therapy and was given pills to chemically castrate him. Emerging from this asylum, Gerber, who was a German immigrant, was given the choice of either entering an internment camp or joining the military and entering World War I. He chose the military. Working in Germany as a translator for the Allies, he traveled to Berlin. There, he met other same-sex desiring men, took part in a bustling queer subculture. He began reading queer publications, and he joined the first homosexual rights organization in the world. He returned to the U.S. in the early 1920s and made it his mission to bring what he termed homosexual emancipation to the United States, founding the first documented gay rights organization in the U.S. Gerber declared himself the Abraham Lincoln of the homosexuals. He's very modest. But why I'm telling Gerber's story here, his experiences illustrate the ways in which World War I opened up new sexual possibilities, queer communities, and ways of thinking about sexuality in relation to one's rights. This revolutionized the ways in which Americans thought about sexuality in relation to the state. But this is not a reductive narrative of oppression to liberation. It's quite the contrary, actually. The queer community and the liberatory thinking that accompanied it was born out of the US government's growing concern over same-sex desire and their homophobia. It was during and particularly after World War I that the US government, growing in size, first recognized same-sex desire, gave it a name, and outlawed and prosecuted such sexual behavior. You might be wondering now, how did this make room for early gay rights movements? And my answer to that is, while outlawing of queer desire was not liberatory, it did officially name such desire on a large scale and by the US government. This changed everything. By naming and defining such desire, the government gave homosexuality a sort of legitimacy by merely recognizing its existence. And through naming and defining it, even in this negative context, queer folks had a collective identity and shared experiences of homophobic prejudice to organize around. World War I brought same-sex desiring people together, exposing them to new people, new ideas, that in turn helped them create the early homophile movements. Thus, I argue that World War I helped define, solidify, and make legible queer identities, creating a stable queer subject that serves as the foundation for these communities, cultures, and movements to take root through the 20th century. So tonight, I'm going to discuss the emergence of homosexuality as a sexual category in relation to the state, the experiences these soldiers had during World War I, and the world they created when they came home, and that world's legacy. So to understand sexuality in World War I, we must first understand the social climate in the United States prior to the war. The beginning of the 20th century witnessed social change on a large scale. We have the women's rights movement and suffrage movements that emerge out of the 19th century and grow throughout the early 20th. And these women are challenging gender roles and what it means to be a woman and connecting that to their rights as citizens. We also have, following the failure of Reconstruction, Black Americans challenging white supremacy and Jim Crow America, in which separate but equal was the law of the land. Black Americans contested white America through mass demonstrations. And this, of course, brought race into question. And then we have the labor movement, challenging class systems and shedding light on the exploitation of the working class, asking for the government as them as citizens to protect them. So we can see a lot of social and political change, and this understanding of collective identity and collective identity connecting itself to rights and understanding of rights. So with this in mind, this also then extended to sexuality. Now, sexuality is a new concept during this time, and it emerges out of a new science called sexology. Now, when I say sexuality is a new concept, particularly homosexuality being a new concept, that is in no way saying that this is something that just started happening. Same-sex desiring people existed throughout time and all over the world. But the term homosexuality and the idea of sexual identity emerges in the late 19th and early 20th centuries and emerges out of German-speaking Central Europe through this science called sexology, or the science of sex. Prior to sexology, people had sex. It was acts. You could have sex with somebody of the same gender, and that did not define who you were. But then with the advent of sexology, which is connected to the birth of the nation state being kind of this cohesive state that kind of we identify today. With the birth of the nation state, we see the state becoming interested in the sexual health and reproduction of its citizens. And we see the nation state start policing sexuality and the sexual health. Sexologists, these physicians, identify homosexuality, this term they coined in 1869. So homosexuality, or same-sex desire, they see that as a disease. And it's a disease that harms the nation state. It does not produce more citizens. And they see it harming the nation state also because it could spread. So it was no longer about who, it's no longer about sexual acts and being punished for doing wrong sexual acts, right? Sexuality now became central to one's being. Sexologists began looking at people's bodies, taking their case histories, and arguing that homosexuality, sexuality in general, defined in a person. It was about their identity, their psyche, their biology, everything. It was their core self. And if that core was rotten, if it was homosexual, there was a defect, and they were understood as diseased. So this move from sexual acts to sexual identity is key to understanding the world that these soldiers were experiencing, these same-sex desiring soldiers were experiencing, as well as how the military begins to understand this. So here we can see they were reading bodies. This is an image from a sexologist. Here we have more images from sexologists. Reading bodies and trying to figure people out. They believed that if somebody could whistle, that meant, oh, they could be homosexual. If your index finger and your ring finger were the same length, that could mean you were homosexual. They're trying to read bodies and place meaning on these bodies. With people who were same-sex desiring now be understood as disease, there were treatments, unfortunately. And we still have things like this today, very sadly. So local municipalities began invoking laws, making homosexuality illegal. This is at, like I said, the local level. And one thing that they're doing is also prescribing these treatments. So we have forced sexual intercourse with the opposite sex, institutionalization, imprisonment, castration, clitoridectomy, electroshock therapy, which is a very new thing they were experimenting with, as was lobotomy, and even encouraging suicide. So when we think about World War I and the world in which this is happening in, this is central. The upheaval of social systems, including gender, race, class, and sexuality, paralleled the upheaval and political unrest taking place in Europe as the continent plunged into war. So just as sexologists are beginning to define and police sexuality, the US government is influenced by these ideas and takes them on. So it's not until World War I that sexologists' ideas and pathologization of queer desire made its way into federal policy, particularly through the military. So with the Selective Service Act in 1917, the nation drafted 2.8 million men into service. The US government grew exponentially with bureaucratic agencies that were created to support the war. The growth of the US government led to the naming and policing of sexuality as never before. For the first time in American history, the US began screening for homosexuals by adopting the language of sexology that defined homosexuality as, quote, a psychiatric perversion. Instead of policing acts, which the military did before, it was illegal to, it wasn't officially illegal, but it was legal to commit sodomy. But for the first time, they put this in the books. Okay, so in March 1917, the US revises the 1806 Articles of War, and it criminalizes assault with the intent to commit sodomy. Now, it's important to mention they do this a month before the US declares war on the German Empire. That's not a coincidence. A month before. According to new military screening guidelines, doctors advise examiners that the degenerate male physique as a whole is often marked by diminished stature and inferior vigor. So they are looking and trying to read bodies just as sexologists were. The examiners were warned to watch out for recruits who, quote, present the general bodily form of the opposite sex with sloping narrow shoulders, broad hips, excessive breast tissue, small penises, and a lack of masculine hair and muscular markings. These guidelines mark the military's first serious concern with a homosexual culture developing in its ranks. While they're putting this into their screening and they're making these rules, we find that few soldiers were actually ensnared by these screenings. So while they are looking at these soldiers and examining them in these ways, the examiners really don't know how to utilize or enforce these rules. We have to remember a lot of work goes into defining and policing things like sexuality. And these bureaucrats are figuring it out and creating it, these ideas, as they go. We see that many men who fell into these categories, they would often make reference to that, but then they kind of just let it go. So they would mark it in their records, but then it would say, oh, he was inducted nonetheless. So while it appears that not many men were ensnared by these new guidelines, there were some who were. And this violence and humiliation is something to absolutely consider, because they were targeted and then faced court-martial and discharge from the military. So this is very important to think about as we think about this war. How are they thinking about these soldiers? How are they thinking about health? And how are they thinking about same-sex desire? So while we understand how the military was understanding these men, now let's think about the experience of the soldier themselves. While military regulations police same-sex desire with soldiers in mind, it is important to consider what they were doing, how they were thinking. The sources available to historians regarding this period, and pretty much any period prior to the 1950s, are few and far between. For my presentation, I'm using mainly letters, medical records, military records, and oral histories. But you'll notice that I'm primarily focusing on men. And the reason is not because women were not also same-sex desiring during this time, but mainly because the laws and sexologists were themselves men and really could not understand how women, to be quite honest, they couldn't understand how women had sex without men. And they couldn't understand how these women would even want to have sex without men, because women were understood as lacking that sort of sexual passion. So we don't have a lot of records about these women and what they were doing, but I will turn to them after the war because they do create amazing communities after the war. But with the little information that I, or with the information that I do have on the men, we know that same-sex desiring soldiers were both recruited or volunteered, and were they were also drafted. Sorry, queer men who wrote about their decision to join the war had vastly different explanations. Some joined because they wanted a homosocial environment where they could be men. And they use very misogynistic language. Others wanted to prove their masculinity, prove they weren't effeminate. And many soldiers, like anyone else in the US, wanted to serve their country and use patriotic language to describe their decision. And sadly, there were many accounts of same-sex desiring soldiers who wanted to join the military as a suicidal act. One such soldier was Fred S. of Cleveland, Ohio, who wrote to German sexologist Magnus Hirschfeld. He wrote, "It is my greatest wish to get into the field as soon as possible and meet an honorable death, for otherwise I'll be compelled later on to make an end of my rotten life due to my homosexual tendencies, for which I am not responsible. It is better that my mother should be able to say my Freddie died a heroic death for his country than that people should say, oh, a suicide, eh? In the end, Fred got his peace, the peace he longed for, dying a month before the armistice. The hate Fred felt for himself was not uncommon during this period, that internalized hatred affected many soldiers during this time, making suicide so common among queer folks. But regardless of their reason for joining, men from across the US of various races, ethnicities, class backgrounds, from rural and urban settings with differing sexual experiences were brought together by the war. And as historian Elizabeth Heinemann says, we need to consider the layering of young men's experiences, sexual or otherwise, as they travel to the front. For example, it's important to think about how this happens. So you start in your community of origin. You might not have ever met anyone else who was same-sex desiring. You couldn't maybe not even know the term, or that there are other people like you. That's something we see quite a bit. People writing, "I didn't know there was anyone else but like me." From there, you would go to a base for training, often in a different region of the country, where you first come into contact with people from all over the United States with different experience, different cultures, and you're exposed to these new ideas. And then you would continue your travels. You go to England. You then are meeting ally soldiers from other nations and exposed to even more ideas. And then when you are on furlough, you are going to neighboring countries in contact with the locals. As Heinemann explains, the accumulation of these experiences in multiple settings, it shapes these enlisted men's behaviors and their identities. Now let's think about what these men are doing. We connect through storytelling. That's all history is storytelling. And we connect through storytelling. That's how we make meaning in relationships. These men are doing the same thing. They're sitting in their bunks, they're at the table eating, they're in trenches, sharing their experiences, telling stories from home, bragging about their sexual experiences, probably embellishing. And this is crucial for queer soldiers. Like I said, many of them never met other men like them. One soldier talks about how, "I never met one like me until I came to the Navy." And he says, "This is something I never did until I came in here." Another serviceman discussed how he had to be very careful. He wasn't sure if same-sex desiring men, if he was reading them correctly. And they created these incredible friendships. Some created romances and supported each other through this heinous time in their life. And then we also just think about, like I said, the time off, right? What are these soldiers doing when they are given a bit of leave? And many of them are going going into town, going to particularly Germany. They're particularly interested in Germany, mainly because that's where they are. And also because Berlin was known to have, and many of them learned about this, a thriving queer culture. So you have to remember that sexology emerged in German-speaking Central Europe. Unlike in the US, many of the most prominent sexologists in Germany were more sympathetic to queer folks, arguing that homosexuality was congenital and not to be punished. Magnus Hirschfeld, pictured here, was one such sexologist, and he founded the first gay rights organization that we know of in 1897 called the Scientific Humanitarian Committee. He was a sexologist and, like I said, a queer man himself. The Scientific Humanitarian Committee gathered over 5,000 signatures from prominent German Americans to petition to overturn laws on the federal level against homosexuality. And they had signatures included Albert Einstein, Hermann Hesse, and Thomas Mann. Hirschfeld even wrote and acted in a film entitled Anders als die anderen, Different from the Others. And it made its premiere in Berlin in 1919. In addition to the work of the homosexual rights movement, we see a thriving gay culture. Here we have Hirschfeld enjoying it himself. And there's a thriving nightlife. There are people having drag balls, costume parties, drinking, music. On top of that, we see a lot of publications. Der Eigene, which was the Unique, was the first gay magazine or journal published in the world. This is in Germany. And it's published between 1896 and 1932. We see many soldiers buying these periodicals. And even if they couldn't read them, they could look at the pictures. They have affairs and meet new people. And this influences them and what they bring home with them. So now we're going to think about what's going on after the war. The US government is what we're going to look at first. So there are, because of so many homosexual folks and the government kind of knowing about this during the war, they again make revisions to the Articles of War. So remember, we have the first revisions a month before the war, before America joins the war in 1917. It's then again revised in 1920. And so no longer is it simply about this idea that sodomy is somehow an assault. There isn't consent between two people. Now they just make sodomy illegal. They don't talk about consent. Because before they're imagining it as a sort of attack, one person attacking another. In the second revision, they're thinking about it as consensual between two people. There's a reason for that, because they see how prevalent same-sex desire is during the war, and particularly in the event of the Newport scandal. The Newport scandal happens in Rhode Island at the Navy base there. And we see this moment where homosexuality in the military makes the national newspapers. So what happened was in March of 1919, Irvin Arnold, who is an enlisted man in the Navy, heard from another enlisted man that there is this thriving gay culture. They hang out at the local YMCA and several art clubs, and they have sex with each other. He was appalled and reported it to his superiors. His superiors reacted and say, "You must look into this further." And they create a sting operation using good-looking men from the Navy to infiltrate homosexual undergrounds and get evidence needed to convict. Not only would these investigators be expected to gain access to these queer communities, they also had to collect the evidence through sexual acts. As a result of this, we have 20 enlisted men and 15 local men who were not part of the military, 15 civilians charged. The enlisted men are convicted and discharged and under court-martial. Civilians, on the other hand, were sent to a federal trial where the judge was appalled by what happened. He couldn't believe that the military had forced young men to have sex with other men in this sting operation. He threw out their testimonies and said that, quote, "The investigators who admitted to personally taking part in these sexual activities are just as guilty as the men who they were investigating." So at this point, he pointed out that no government could order men to engage in homosexual contact against their will. And if they were willing participants, on the other hand, how were they any less guilty? His decision makes the newspapers. And the Secretary of the Navy, Josephus Daniels, and Assistant Secretary of the Navy, Franklin D. Roosevelt, authorize this investigation. And they are held accountable. Roosevelt is very angry with the press. There's an entire investigation. And like I said, this forever changes the articles of war. And then we'll see later in World War II, this go even further. This then affects men in World War II and the policing that they experience. So then we have what's going on culturally after the war. So when these folks come home, they are thinking about their world differently. Many of them are disillusioned with society. They experience, after the horrors of war, we see the 1920s forever remembered for kind of the sexual freedom experimentation We have the emergence of lesbian nightclubs in the cities like New York and Chicago that emerge out of these new ideas about sexuality that come from the war. This is one of my favorite things to teach, and my students love learning about this. We have lesbian nightclubs emerging in these cities where particularly Black jazz artists such as Ma Rainey, Gladys Bentley, who's pictured here, Bessie Smith, Lucille Bogan, performed music openly discussing lesbian desire and relationships. They were in the life, which is another term for kind of like being out of the closet. And here's a map of the Harlem nightlife at the time. We have Gladys's Clam House, a club where Gladys Bentley performed, the Lafayette Theater. These are all hot spots for queer entertainment and for queer communities to organize and come together and drink and dance, and do all those fun things. I play the music for my students from these artists. I have them analyze the lyrics, things of that sort. It's one of their favorite, favorite weeks that we study together. Another thing that emerges from this period, particularly for lesbian women, are the records. You don't have to be in Chicago or New York to hear this music. Here we have Paramount. Paramount is putting out records from these lesbian, bisexual women, these artists. Here we have Ma Rainey's Prove It On Me Blues. There are two cops in the back watching her flirt with two flappers. And the point of the song is like, the police can't do anything to me, they gotta prove it on me. And she openly sings these songs. People could buy these records and listen to them no matter where they were. And it was that kind of out in the open. Another great thing is that many of these women were bisexual. And so that's really great for students to learn about too, the history of bisexuality. And that is not a new concept. We also have the publication of The Well of Loneliness by Radcliffe Hall. This emerges from her experiences as an ambulance driver during the war. She is a British author, and she writes a book about a kind of a coming of age tale of a woman who is same-sex desiring. And this book was groundbreaking. This wasn't the first time this was covered, but it was groundbreaking because nobody died at the end. Usually in books, queer characters had to be punished for their desire, and that punishment usually came through death. In this book, though it doesn't end happily for the couple, no one died at the end. And that was groundbreaking. It was made illegal, the book, in England. Here in the US, it was not illegal. It was not taken off the shelves because there was technically there are no sex scenes in it. And that's how they measured propriety in literature. So because there are no sex scenes, people could get access to it. They could get it out of the library. They could go buy it at the bookstore. And this served as a foundational text for the lesbian community throughout the 1920s. Women in the 1970s, when the lesbian rights movements and feminist movements are really coming together, they are buying this book to read. So this has profound implications. We also have the Harlem Renaissance. So following the war with the Great Migration, we have folks of color migrating to cities in the Northeast and the Midwest and the West Coast eventually. And in Harlem, of course, we have this incredible community of Black artists. And many of these artists, including the founder of the Harlem Renaissance, Alan Locke, are same-sex desiring. And they write about their sexuality, and they write about their race and kind of taking an intersectional approach. So we have people like Langston Hughes, like I said, Alan Locke, Angelina Grimke, all these folks, Bruce Nugent, whose work I use in the classroom, writing about sexuality. In the case of like Bruce Nugent and Angelina Grimke, they're both bisexual and both biracial, mixed race people. And so I find that their text to be particularly great for students to think about these middle grounds that they write about not fitting in. So I find those texts particularly great in the classroom. And we also have drag balls emerging. If your students are watching Pose or other shows right now with this theme, they're gonna recognize this and they get very excited about the drag balls. And these are particularly in communities of color, though also in white communities. And they are very elaborate celebrations of gender nonconformity, gender non-binary identities. So also a great topic to look at. And these definitely emerge from World War I. This is what soldiers were seeing when they were going to the clubs in Berlin. Now I'm going to end with who I began with, Henry Gerber. So after the war, Gerber comes home. He has all of his magazines, all of the experiences he had, the works of Hirschfeld. He comes home and he decides that he wants to start a homophile movement in the US. He got a job with the Postal Service and he explained that, quote, "I had always bitterly felt the injustice with which my own American society accused the homosexual of immoral acts. I hated the society which allowed the majority, frequently corrupt itself, to persecute those who deviated from the established norms in sexual matters. I thought to myself that if I succeeded, I might become known as the deliverer of the downtrodden, even as Lincoln. But I am not sure my thoughts were entirely upon fame. If I succeeded in freeing the homosexual, I too would benefit." So, with the help of his boss, Gerber wrote a declaration of purpose, which he named his organization the Society for Human Rights. And he was able to gather a small membership, mainly of working class queer folks. Chicago's elite didn't want to be a part of it because they didn't want to get in trouble. They had more to lose, essentially. So we have the John T. Graves, a same-sex desiring African-American clergyman named president, Al Weiniger, a man Gerber later described as an indignant laundry queen, was vice president, and then Gerber was the secretary. It was expressly for gay men. They didn't want to have really anything to do with women. And they didn't want bisexual men in this organization because they thought that it would, quote, get too messy. So together they formed a three-point strategy for homosexual emancipation. First, they wanted to change society's view of same-sex desire through lectures and education. Second, they aimed to keep the homophile world in touch through the organization's publication. They're inspired by what they saw abroad, and they are thinking of their community as transnational. That I think is very important. And third, they sought to change legislation, making same-sex desire punishable through law. So in a very bold move on their part, they submitted their constitution to the Secretary of State in Illinois, and were furnished with a state charter. They were incredibly surprised, thinking no one seemed to have bothered to investigate our purpose. However, they were careful to make their purposes not too clear in the application. And nonetheless, afterwards, they started holding meetings. They created a newsletter and publication called Friendship and Freedom. And they even sent a copy to Hirschfeld in Germany. Sadly, the organization was short-lived. By the summer of 1925, all the men were arrested. Their publication, Gerber's journals, everything was confiscated. Weiniger apparently did have a family. He was married. His wife found out, got upset, and called the police. And Gerber spent all of his savings bribing lawyers to defend them and trying to get them out of jail. He eventually does. So after his release, Gerber loses his job with the post office, and he leaves Chicago for New York and starts living with some friends that he met during the war. He's encouraged to join the military again. And even though he was convicted for homosexual acts, he was enlisted again and served for 17 years. He later died in 1972 in a Washington soldier's home. And he's remembered now when you go to Chicago, there's the Gerber Hart Archives, and there's a plaque outside his apartment where he was arrested. He's starting to be recognized for the work he did. So I'm going to end my talk thinking about how World War II made room for these largely, later on, these organizations and cultures, how the war made room for them. We forget or don't know about these because the 1920s, of course, led into the Great Depression. And both Americans and Europeans alike blamed the liberalism and the sexual decadence of the 1920s for the fall, the Great Fall. Nightclubs closed in Harlem and Berlin, and policing of same-sex desire rose. These thriving subculture or these thriving cultures then had to turn into underground subcultures again, and their legacy, though not extinguished, also sort of went underground. But it does a disservice to these folks to forget what they did. And I particularly like thinking about how their legacy lived on into the modern 1970s, 60s and 70s gay liberation movements. So in the 1950s, a young man named Harry Hay was cruising and he met a man from Chicago who had recently moved to the area. And he talked about this club he used to be in called the Society for Human Rights. And he talked about his ex-lover, Gerber. He described the group and its goals and its demise. Harry Hay was so inspired, he's founded the Mattachine Society, which is credited as the organization to begin the modern LGBTQ rights movement. While the Mattachine Society was being established, we have a young Radcliffe student around the same time in the 1950s pick up a copy of The Well of Loneliness and realize that she was not alone in her desire. Her name was Adrienne Rich, and she would go on to become one of the most influential feminist lesbian writers of the 20th century. So it's so important to be teaching this. While scholars of queer history have often argued that the Second World War was the catalyst for modern LGBTQ rights movements, I think that such arguments ignore the impact of the First World War. We like the narrative of gay liberation being post-World War II because it gives us a clean story of people moving from hiding in the closet to marching in the streets. However, as we know, history is never that neat and tidy. World War I and the world that emerged from it complicate this narrative and give us a richer understanding of what these folks went through and the worlds they created. And I think it's so important as educators for us to talk about world making and how even in these trying times, the queer community was able to thrive, to find each other, to make connections, to survive and thrive in a hostile world. Thank you.
Caroline, thank you so very much. As you are coming back onto the screen and as folks are populating more questions into that Q&A, I did want to share some of our thanks as well to our partners in this particular lecture, the United States World War I Centennial Commission, who have been partners with us in educational endeavors since their founding in 2013. Coming up in 2021, they'll be opening up a second national memorial. That means World War I will be the only memorial with two, the only war with two national memorials inside the United States. That'll be opening up in DC. You can find out more about that at their website, ww1cc.org. Also, we are partners with them in the Educator Resource Toolkit, wwichangedus.org, that includes a variety of topics, including women in World War I and other things. Each of those topics is a video, primary source activity, and lesson plan. We've got a resource database, and in that we do include some lessons, including this one with our partners over at UC Davis. This one is out for safe schools and looking at what role did female impersonations in various soldier camps performances play in allowing soldiers to explore their identity. We also, again, partner with the World War I Centennial Commission in understanding the Great War newsletter. That goes out every other month. So this next month is actually in November. We're going to be sending out a newsletter on fashion and World War I. So we would love for you to join us on that or look at any of the archive. And we invite you to take a look at our online collections database where there are more than 40,000 images and research resources at your fingertips, including images like this one, which Dr. Radesky mentioned in her talk. This is actually an invitation to a cross-dressing ball. We also have in our collection a letter from William E. Letts that discusses this a little bit more further. And he says in November 30th of 1918 that there was a petty officer of HM Ships, Agincourt, Orion, Thunderer, and Conqueror gave a dinner and dance to our men. They had all of their young and good-looking boys dressed up as girls for us to dance with, and believe me, some of them made nice girls. If you go down a little bit further, it says, the only trouble was the powder came off of Mabel's arms and cheeks when you were too close together. You could easily tell what sailor had hugged his girl and tell what one was shy or a married man, for they had no powder on their backs. There is information and primary sources if you care to be looking for it. And clearly you do because you are here with us in conversation this evening. Now, if you are a teacher, you might be looking for the credit, the PD credit. This is going to be the password for the lecture. This particular round, that link will be sent out in an email later this week. It'll also be provided in the YouTube channel descriptor. All right, so we've got some really great questions. Caroline, we'll start with the first, one of the first ones which actually goes straight to sources and where some of them came from. Thomas Hull asked, as a fellow Clevelander, is there more information about Fred S? In part, where also can you find that archive?
Oh, absolutely. So Fred S, that actually comes from Magnus Hirschfeld. He writes a book about sexuality during World War I. And it goes through his, it's from his records. This man wrote into him. Unfortunately, the Hirschfeld archive was burned by the Nazi party because, so the Nazis, of course, did go after homosexual folks. They were also in the concentration camps. So one of the first things they did when they got into power was go to Magnus Hirschfeld's offices and burn all of his books and his research. So we have it because it was published. Unfortunately, to be quite honest, I don't know how you would necessarily track this person down, but that's such a good question. I wish there were a way to know more.
And speaking more to, clearly you have won people into that story of these individuals. Laura Sears asked, by chance, do you know what Gerber did in the army the second time he served?
Yes, he was mainly working, that's such a good question. He was mainly working, doing desk work. He was in between New York and New Jersey. And he was still, we have some oral histories from him, and he wrote a bit towards the end of his life. Remember, he dies in 1972. And so the gay rights movement was kind of coming into its own at that point. And I can only imagine what he was like. He sounds like he was fun. But he really wanted people to know this history, and he began writing down what he did. And people began interviewing him because we have the beginnings of kind of queer history as we know it today. And he wrote that he was still having a good time in New York and New Jersey. He just kept it a little more, he was better at hiding things, I think is kind of how he put it. He didn't try to start another organization.
Didn't apply to the state of Illinois. That, no. It's a step in what? Hiding, being a little more subtle on. As Stephen Slaughter asked, is there any information or accounts about queer servicemen of color and how their experiences would shape various movements?
That is such an important question. I haven't been able to find much on that, mainly because the records are already so few and far between, and the way that they organized troops based on race and the records that were kept so different. So unfortunately, I haven't been able to find anything. I've looked at veterans who later I know were same sex as I study race in my dissertation. That's what I'm looking at. And they don't really talk about their time during the war. So I haven't found any documents about that, but if anyone knows of anything, please let me know, because that's a major hole in this narrative. And we have the same thing during World War II, very, again, few and far between, but there's a bit more in World War II.
All right, and I believe that this is actually Reese Dotson, who asks, do you think the popularity of the eugenics movement facilitated the rise of sexology in the early 20th century?
They're absolutely hand in hand. So yeah, we have Galton in the 1870s and 60s begin to look at statistics and begin to look at what is normal. The idea of statistics and normality emerge during that time. And to define what is normal, you have to define what's not normal. And so the sexologists are very much embedded in those conversations. They're also embedded in Galton's cousin's work on evolutionary thought. And So they, yeah, absolutely go hand in hand. There's a program in the United States to encourage, well, definitely to discourage people who are same-sex desiring and in marriages to procreate. And there's forced sterilization as well for people who particularly were in asylums at the time and would be forcibly sterilized. They were worried that they would enter into certain relationships and then pass on those genes to their kin. So that's a really good question. They completely go hand in hand. You're absolutely right.
There's so many good questions. And I know that we're running a little bit over time, but I'm going to go ahead and just see if we can get some of the, some more fast answers here. Talking about, defining normal, Linda Granfield says, so many interesting points, Professor. I'm thinking the Hays Act reflects the nervousness of the government and the sexuality depicted in the early films. Your thoughts?
Yes, absolutely. I recently taught the Hays Act, another week that students really enjoy. Yes. It's absolutely connected to ideas of normality and seeing how one should conduct theirself, right? How through the Hays codes, you learn what it means to be, you know, a certain type of person through film. And then the way that people will just look for crumbs of any sort of representation of themselves. And, you know, even if it's, you know, you have to watch a film and there's like a lesbian vampire, but you'll still watch the film because you just want to see yourself represented. Absolutely. That's such a great point. Thank you.
Talking about looking for things, this was a really good point. Do you find many or any records of folks who completely eschewed sexuality? T.E. Lawrence is famously possibly asexual, but it's hard to find an absence of something.
Right. Right. So looking for asexuality and things. Yes, this is something that I would say that asexuality isn't necessarily an absence. It's its own sexuality. And I think that I come across as teaching a subject like this in college. I have a lot of students who I'm very lucky who confide in me, and we will talk about, you know, their experiences and things like that. And asexuality is something they really want to see, and there just isn't writing or resources on it. I think it's such an exciting time to be in this field. I desperately love teaching this and being in this field. And I hope that we can get to a time where we can find sources like this. One book came out a few years ago. It was a literary analysis of not engaging in sex. I'm losing words, I'm sorry. When you don't engage in sex, you are. I'm sorry,
We are both just chalk it up for it being a historic week.
It's a historic week. I'm gonna go with that. It starts with a C, but I can't think. It's something. But for folks who like purposefully don't engage.
Yeah, people who are celibate, I believe.
Yeah. So there is something being done, but again, it's not asexuality. And I think that that's a really great point that you bring up and something that is missing.
There are other really good questions. Andre, thank you so much. We did talk about a couple of those novels and poems, but I believe that Caroline, you are open to helping provide some more information. Would you want to share how people could contact you if they wanted some more resources for teaching?
Yes. Please contact me. I have lists of books, teaching materials, songs, videos, everything. You can contact me by email. That's kind of the best way to get a hold of me. It's Caroline Radesky, or Caroline-Radesky at uiowa.edu. So please, please contact me. I can send out, and I can also send it to you, Laura, if people want to contact you, but I can send out materials. I have a slideshow that I do for kind of training and things, ways that people can incorporate things that they're queer issues, queer history into what they're already teaching. Yeah. So if you're looking at the jazz era, okay, here's this. If you're looking at the Civil War, all right, we got some there too. So you can very easily add this to your curriculum.
Right. And you can check out our email at education@theworldwar.org, where questions like, is there documentation of transgender people serving in World War I? You got to see some pictures, and I shared with you a letter. So I don't know that all of the intricacy, we're going really short on time right there. That is where you can ask more of those questions, where we will be sure to pass that on to Dr. Radesky, as well as the question here of, is there evidence of replication of gay men who joined the military as a means of suicide in other 20th century wars, or was this more just tied to World War I?
That's such a good question. I haven't seen it. I'm not a historian of, a war historian, but I mean, having read and taught different wars, I've never seen anything like that. I really haven't. I think that there was a shame at this time and this internalized hate, which is not to say we don't deal with that now. I think queer history does this amazing job of problematizing linear narratives of history. But I've never seen another record like that for any other wars. And it's just so tragic. It's such a tragic piece that it's hard to talk about, but yeah, I haven't, but that's just me. I can definitely ask around if that would be helpful.
Well, and Dr. Radesky, thank you so much for coming into this space and talking about this really important history and talking about ways that we can integrate it into a larger conversation and to bring light to history that has always been there. It just hasn't necessarily been shared. Thank you for an enlightening conversation. Thank you for your willingness to be contacted for more with more questions. And we look forward to doing some more work with you in the future.
Oh, thank you so much. This was so wonderful. And I appreciate all these brilliant questions and all the work that you put into this, Laura. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And thank you all for joining us. Have a wonderful day.